From May 1944 to December 1945, Sergeant Frank Walsh served alongside frontline forces in the Pacific, not as a soldier or pilot, but as a medical orderly with the RAAF.
I found his diaries and the letters so revealing about what was going on, seeing I was a small child during the turmoil of World War II. My parents met at Bridgewater on Loddon. Dad was a relieving teacher in Little Bush schools, and he came into the cafe run by my mum's family, the O'Shaughnessys, and voila, he met my mother, who was this pretty girl with butter on her fingers making sandwiches. After being engaged a year, they married.
On the 9th of February, I enlisted in the Royal Australian Air Force as a technical trainee and was stationed at the exhibition buildings in Melbourne. Reen and our dear Paula boarded opposite at Royal Terrace, 62 Nicholson Street.
It was wonderful that Dad had contact with me while he was stationed here, because we lived opposite in the Bluestone Terrace. And his mates would call out present when there was a roll call, and he would go AWOL and come over and babysit me. And he writes in his diary, "I don't know how long I've got to hold my baby." So I tear up now when I read that again.
I had hoped to become an aircraft electrician, but I found the course too difficult. So I chose to become a medical orderly.
On the 8th of May 1943, Frank departs Townsville by sea for No. 5 Medical Receiving Station, Goodenough Island, via Milne Bay in New Guinea. With large airstrips, Goodenough Island was used by the RAAF and US Air Force to mount strikes against Japanese positions throughout the Pacific.
3rd of August. It's Paula's second birthday tomorrow. How I wish I could be home for it. I'm just living for the day when I should see my two dears again. We're now packing to go to Biak in Dutch New Guinea, which the Yanks have just taken. It's about 1,000 miles from here. Tuesday, 11th September. Arrived Biak, 10:30 a.m. Can see where the bombs and shells have cut the vegetation to bits. Much evidence of Japanese occupation. Dead bodies and equipment everywhere. Still plenty of live ones about. They often come down to give themselves up.
Frank's diary entries ceased from October 1944 until he began writing again in early 1945.
We soon had 100 patients with only 5 orderlies to look after them day and night. We practically ran ourselves to a standstill. Made acting corporal on 10th of January.
He probably felt that was not as important, the medical orderly role, as a bomber pilot or a soldier who had to go out and kill.
Wednesday, 14th of February. Reached Moratai. We are jammed in, north, south, east and west. A real Australian and Japanese sandwich. The perimeter is only 4 miles away. Can hear the sounds of guns quite clearly.
Just 2 days after arriving at Moratai Island, Frank is injured in a vehicle accident, and he's lucky to survive.
Quite a lot has happened since the last entry. Germany has surrendered. Mussolini, Hitler, Goebbels and Goering are all dead. I've applied for my discharge, but doubt that I shall get it.
On the 20th of June, Frank is posted to Labuan Island off the coast of Borneo. Once a Japanese stronghold, it's now part of the final push towards victory. He disembarks just days after Australian forces wrestle control from the Japanese.
It looks to be just a mass of ruins. The whole foreshore is terribly battered.
Overwhelmed with work, Frank once again neglects his diary. By October 1945, Frank is back in hospital, this time with acute appendicitis. But it's not all bad news. He learns that his discharge has been approved and that he will be medically evacuated within days.
Maybe a civvy by next Sunday. Spent 2 days making bracelets and a necklace from shells for Paula and Reen. I can't imagine what it'd be like to sleep within four walls again and not have to worry about the rain coming in or the tent blowing down.
On Sunday, October 21st, Frank touched down in Melbourne. He was reunited with his wife and daughter the next day.
These men were jumping off the train and running towards their families, and this man ran towards my mum and gave her a huge kiss and took me out of her arms, and I was so frightened. I didn't know my dad.
He was discharged from the RAAF on December the 15th, 1945.
He didn't talk a lot about the war. One day, he wanted to come and walk outside the Royal Exhibition buildings to remember those days of those wonderful young men and women donating their lives literally for our country.